Good evening, I'm Christian Esguera, and welcome to this episode of After the Fact, where we get to see things more clearly, where we get a better sense of the truth. Let's begin by dissecting the news. More than 560 members of the Catholic Church hierarchy have come forward to endorse the presidential candidacy of Vice President Lenny Robredo and running mate Senator Francis Pangilinan. Collectively known as Pari Madre Misionero para kay Lenny, the group cited the candidate's public service record unblemished by corruption. A few days ago, the leader of the lay Catholic group El Shaddai also endorsed the son and namesake of the late dictator Ferdinand Marcos and his running mate Sara Duterte. But El Shaddai's spiritual advisor later disowned the endorsement, saying it was, quote, very wrong. Bishop Teodoro Bacani also said that if there's a candidate who shouldn't be elected president, it's Marcos Jr., citing the billions of dollars the Marcoses plundered from public coffers during his father's regime. Later in the campaign, the bloc voting Iglesia ni Cristo sect is also expected to endorse its own candidates. Tonight, we'll talk about the role of faith and religion in Philippine elections. We'll also set the record straight once and for all on a principle misunderstood and often misused, the separation of church and state. Now, be part of our discussion. Send us your questions and comments on our YouTube live chat or tweet us using the hashtag ANCAfterTheFact. Joining us tonight is Brother Armin Luistro, who is among the signatories of the statement of support of the group Pare Madre Misionero para kay Lenny. Is the religious superior of the Lasallian East Asia District. Also with us is Professor Jail Cornelio. He is the director of the Ateneo de Manila University Development Studies Program. He also authored the book Being Catholic in the Contemporary Philippines. Is also the lead editor of the Routledge International Handbook of Religion in Global Society. Good evening, gentlemen, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Evening, Christian. Good evening, Prof. Jail.
Okay. Good evening, Christian. Good evening, Brother Armin. Good to be here.
Let's start with a very basic question we often hear people ask, especially these days as we await the unfolding, campaign for the May elections. Brother Armin, are religious organizations or sects or groups, are they allowed to endorse candidates in an election?
Eh, siyempre naman. Ang tagal na lang sinasabi yan ng simbahan na it's part of our mission to proclaim but also to denounce. No? And if we have to name names, we do. It's not usual, but there are occasions when naming names, denouncing people, values that are being trampled upon is part of the role of the church. Otherwise, bakit pa tayo magsisimba, magdadasal, if we are not citizens of this world as well?
In short, hindi pwedeng blind item. You talk about discernment, you talk about values, but without naming names, hindi pwedeng ganun.
Christian, to be honest, during normal times, pwede naman. But this is a different kind of game because this is an age of disinformation. This is the age of trolls. Kailangan nating sabihin kung ano yung tama at mali na klaro. Eh kung magpapaikot-ikot tayo, eh bakit pa? No? So, and I think that's part of the reason why at this time, you will see a lot of church people coming out publicly. And not just with criteria for elections, but even with actual names.
And what do you say to those who often use, or to be more accurate about it, misuse the principle of the separation of church and state? Each time they see, let's say, a priest endorse certain candidates or try to be political with their statements, especially in the pulpit.
Matagasgas na yan, Christian, because they always quote the Constitution, and Article 3 actually states that it's the state who should not interfere with church affairs. Hindi baliktad dyan, the church has the responsibility, but syempre we have to be prudent. Hindi naman bawat issue dakdakan na dakdak, di ba? So this is a well-meaning, and during appropriate times, it's part of the prophecy of the church.
Okay, Professor Jail, let's try to put this further in context. Yung each time people, whenever they don't like comments coming from priests or religious, they cite the so-called separation of church, although mostly wrongly. Is that a predominant sentiment among Filipinos? And are they being selective?
You find it all the time. Every time a religious organization or religious figure makes a political statement, and then they would simply say, no, you should respect church-state separation and so forth. Obviously, it's a misunderstanding, because what it really means, as Brother Armin has noted, it prohibits the interference of the state in the affairs of the church. But in other interpretations, it also means that the church should not interfere in running the affairs of the state. It has a very specific interpretation insofar as governance is concerned. But when Filipinos use it, most of the time it's because they disagree. They disagree with the statements made by a religious leader or the endorsements made by a religious group in support of a specific candidate or a policy, for example. Sabihin nila, church-state separation naman, dapat walang pakialaman. But that is a mistake, really. Precisely because religious organizations are, like any other entity in society, is a civil society organization. It's like a university. It's like a media organization. Right? It can also be like any business organization. That it can play a role in deepening democracy. So to the extent that it makes a political statement to make us understand complex social issues, I think religious organizations, churches, parishes, communities, are doing their job as good citizens.
Okay, this question is addressed to both of you, the gentlemen, but I'd like Professor Jael to respond to this first. Do you sense an anti-Catholic bias or sentiment each time people wrongly cite the separation of church and state? Because, correct me if I'm wrong, but I hardly monitor this citation of this principle, let's say in the case of Iglesia ni Cristo, which is indeed block voting. They actually tell their members who to vote for. Or more recently, in the case of sect of Pastor Apollo Quibuloy, who actually endorsed a presidential candidate already, Jael.
It can be anti-Catholic. Most of the time, it's really the Catholic Church that is politically aggressive, politically active and present in every sphere of society, if you think about it. So there's that anti-Catholic element, dimension to it, no? But I think it's also circumstantial. Ian and Brother Armin may also comment on this, I suppose. I remember when Iglesia ni Cristo was a big, was controversial back in 2015, wasn't it? Over Laila de Lima and so forth, DOJ. Many Filipinos, Catholics included, would say, no, parang, see, this is what happens when religion always interferes with politics, and politics interferes with religion, and then the separation is blurred. It has been used also on other religious groups. When Brother Eddie Villanueva ran for president twice, 2004, 2010, that question was also raised more than once. But given the aggressiveness, the pervasiveness of the Catholic Church here, I can understand why most of the time it's hurled at people like Brother Armin, who endorses certain candidates and makes political statements.
Okay, Brother Armin, what's your response to that?
Sanay na tayo dyan. Well, you'd recognize that when you are pushing for some unpopular values, you get the brunt of criticism, if not the trolls. So, ang importante naman, Christian and Jael, that we are proclaiming the very values. Hindi siya basta-basta. If you recall, part of the criticism dun sa endorsement ni the Catholic Mike Velarde is that personal yon, hindi masyadong nag-consult sa mga tao, at parang yun yung kanyang palaging ini-endorse sa yung mga hindi ayon sa values ng Catholics, no? So many times it's not only because we endorse certain things or proclaim and denounce, but also because the choices do not go through a process, no? Pag makita mo yung, for example, Catholic Educational Association came up with a statement. Walang pangalan yun, walang pangalan. Pero it denounces Duterte politics. It denounces the Marcos revisionism. That one is very clear. No? So you could at very least sense it's based on certain values. It's not just any candidate because of convenience.
In your case, so sige, gawin natin mas pointed po yung discussion, Brother Armin. You're part of Isambayan and you affix your signature in this latest movement. They call themselves a movement, yung Pare Madre Misionero para kay Lenny. Using the Catholic values as parameters, as criteria, why is it that your choice of endorsement is the right one compared to the choice of endorsement or the one endorsed by Brother Mike Velarde, a Catholic?
Well, ang ginamit namin na criterion, Richard, Ian, is really the criterion that are first of all, the central truth of that is the disinformation campaign. Nakikita namin na a lot of those who are pro-BBM, pro-Marcos, really are basing that on false information. It's important, for example, for schools to teach, we teach them how to pay taxes. Baka naman sabihin, nakikilala kami sa gobyerno. But that is one of the values of the Catholic Church. No? We obey, give to Caesar what is Caesar's. And therefore, we teach our students to pay the right taxes. And here you are, you have a candidate who does not pay taxes four times, sabi ng commissioner Guanzon. You obviously cannot be quiet there because that's exactly what we teach in our schools. So these are based on values. It's not because of affinity. It's not because I'm Ilocano or Bicolano. It's because of the very values that we proclaim in the pulpit, but also in our Catholic schools.
Okay. Jay, let's go to the metaphor that is often attached. It's each time people criticize the Catholic Church hierarchy. Again, we have to make that distinction kasi lahat naman ng Katoliko member of the Catholic Church. Okay. Let's talk about the Catholic Church hierarchy. Each time the members or the leaders of the Catholic Church are criticized by a lot of people, they also make use of that Padre Damaso metaphor. How do you explain that? But parang hanggang ngayon ginagamit pa rin yan.
Yeah. One or two reasons really, Christian. The first is that historically speaking, Filipinos know that the Catholic Church has been, at least in the 20th century, before 1986, was in collusion with powerful people, with the elite. And you can argue, say, that up until now, that seems to be the case. Institutionally speaking, whenever the church is talked about, people don't see it as a church of the poor. No, it's a church of the elite. And that really begs a lot of question about why and, why did it come to this and so forth, But let's put that aside for now. There's that. Tapos pangalawa, it's also because, and this is where, a critical sociological analysis comes in. You have here, even though the Philippines is predominantly Catholic, you have other religious groups that are becoming far more influential. You name it. Iglesia ni Cristo, yes. Kiboloy's Church, Kingdom of Jesus Christ, yes. Evangelical churches as well, yes. We saw it certainly in the 2000s when Brother Eddie Villanueva ran. These are other religious groups that are making their presence felt. And they're politically active. They're politically involved. And they have their own representatives, by the way, up to the level of the Senate. We know that. So this, Padre Damaso and anti-Catholicism is also a symptom. It's also a manifestation of that. Parang finally, from the point of view of the religious minority, the Catholic Church has no monopoly over power.
Okay.
And that calls a lot of, that calls for a lot of reflection on the part of religious people.
Okay, I'd like to elaborate on that, yung binanggit mo, Professor Jail. Mm-hmm. I'd like Brother Armin to respond to that. The idea that the church, even now, is seen as the church of the elite, not of the poor. Do you agree with that? Especially in the context of the PCP, Plenary Council of the Philippines, the so-called preferential option for the poor.
Well, ang una ko itatanong, kung ang simbahan ay elitista ngayon, bakit yung mga pare, madre, brother ay isa sa mga unang nagsalita against EJK. Walang elitista. None of those in the Senate, none of those who have power spoke about the sufferings of those who were being killed. Maybe there are instances when some members of the church collaborate with those in power. But you will recognize that a lot of the voices in the church today are voices that are spoken because we speak for the nameless who are being killed. No? West Philippine Sea, popular ba yan? Yung administration nga, pinamimigay yung Pilipinas. Sino nagsasalita dyan? A lot of those are Catholic clergy, but also Catholic lay people. So, yes, baka meron pa rin Padre Damaso ngayon. Hindi ko naman masasabing wala na yan. Pero, ang criticism sa simbahan ngayon, bakit nyo pinagtatanggol yung mga yan, yung mga durugista yan, mga drug addict yan? That's precisely because it is part of our duty to speak for the powerless. And I suppose majority of the faithful take that to heart. That syempre, kailangan nating tulungan, pero hindi lang pwedeng tulong tayo ng tulong eh. Di ba? Parang, we cannot just bury the dead. We also have to shout for the justice of the living.
Okay. J.E., let's go to the issue of how significant or influential our religious organizations really are in the context of Philippine election campaigns. What they think, for example, not just the Catholic Church, you mentioned the evangelicals earlier, mayroong napakalaking organization, yung PCEC, for example. So, nararamdaman natin ang influence niyan during elections and even after elections. So, specifically in this particular election in May, how significant do you think is the religious, our religions, when it comes to influencing or affecting preferences?
There are two ways to answer that, Christian. On the one hand, pwede natin tingnan in terms of statistics, in terms of numbers. No? At pag ganun ang perspective natin, then we know that Iglesia ni Cristo trumps everybody else, right? Because it has the numbers, it's in the millions, and we know that the adherence rate, meaning to say people who follow the endorsements of their central administration, is at around 70% on average, no? At least in the past two elections, plus. So, statistically, we know that Iglesia ni Cristo is influential and all other religious groups are not. So, pwedeng ganun. But on the other hand, and this is where the democratic participation of religious groups comes in, and this is also significant, even though it's not the numbers game that I was talking about just now. Mahalaga kasi yung contribution ng faith communities in deepening the conversations in their circles, in their vicinities. So the Catholic Church is obviously doing that. And certainly in the time of Duterte, as Brother Armin pointed out, yes, that is true. I am not sure, however, Christian, whether we can say the same thing about evangelical communities. I have been embroiled in many controversies involving other evangelical churches kasi nga, especially in my writings, I am very critical about what I would consider the unwillingness of many influential evangelical churches to really, you know, say no when injustices are pretty strong and pretty flagrant, you know, over the war on drugs, for example, and my research shows that. Nahihinayang ako dun sa pagkakataon na in their faith communities and in their fellowships, mapalalim yun eh. And most of the time, these churches are always oriented towards the micro stuff, you know, the welfare of the person, being blessed, etc. So nawawala yung political acumen that was there in 1986. Certain evangelical groups led by Dr. Mel Lumagay, ISAC, or sila Isabelo Magalit, Diliman Bible Church, they were there. Not the majority, but they were there. Mm. Other churches are also playing that role, and I hope that they will continue to do so.
Do you see these churches somehow playing a significant role in this current campaign for the May elections? Because, for example, aside from the Iglesia ni Cristo, which is clearly block voting, I don't think, and political scientists can also weigh in on this, no? I don't think the Iglesia, the El Shaddai movement has actually shown any significant influence that could tilt the balance between, let's say, two opposing candidates. Wala naman silang block voting, technically, di ba? Even if their leader endorses someone. So, ano nakikita mong role lang, ano? Can they actually make a difference in this election?
No. So far as endorsements are concerned, endorsements?
And other churches.
Not to the extent that Iglesia Ni Cristo does it. So kaya nga eh. So kung statistics, kung numbers game matitingnan natin, then we know that Iglesia Ni Cristo trumps everybody else, no? Pero kung in terms of deepening spiritualities, conversations are concerned, baka doon eh. And I do know that there is also a generational component dito. Ian, nabanggit mo yung book ko, for example, at the onset. You have a lot of young people who are questioning their own faith leaders and ministers and pastors, even inside Iglesia Ni Cristo, by the way. We gotta highlight that. They do not necessarily agree with what their central administration is saying. They don't know how to air their disagreements, but they are asking questions. And I feel that these are the people that could be, the voices of these people could be harnessed. And many of them might even later on agree with what Brother Armin and his group and other religious people are doing. Okay. Baka doon magkaroon ng solidarities.
Okay. My next question for Brother Armin. I hope this shouldn't be seen in any shape or form as something that hews closely to the idea of theocracy. Ang gusto ko pag-usapan dito, yung function ng faith in terms of guiding a Catholic voter in scrutinizing a candidate. Hindi ito yung blind following of the faith. No? Kunwari, sinabi ni Brother Armin, vote for this candidate, I endorse this candidate. Hook, line, and sinker, talaga yun ang iboboto niya. But how do you deepen the role of faith and the Catholic values for a particular Catholic voter in terms of scrutinizing candidates? How do you do it?
Yung term na ginagamit at proseso na ginagamit ng Catholic Church is discernment. Pag mapapansin mo, even the so-called endorsements of the big groups always carry a qualifier na this is how we see things. We share this with you for your own reflection, prayer, and discernment. Kasi central to the Catholic discernment is conscience, eh? Personal conscience. Walang pwedeng tumapak dyan. So you'll notice that even bishops who come up with their named endorsements always say, this is what we think, what we feel. We share this with you. But at the end of the day, the Catholic voter will have to use the conscience. Huh? And iyan klarong klaro yan sa bawat Katoliko. Nobody can go beyond and step on one's conscience.
Sorry, I was muted. But Brother Armin, is conscience enough after discernment? Because we also know that there's such a thing as a conscience which is not well formed.
Kaya naman, you will notice that some people actually go beyond the usual, the normal political environment where masasabi natin na there is a space where people can think and feel and discuss. Pero during times of, for example, martial law, cardinals in coming out very, very openly. Church people, mga madre, punta tayo sa EDSA. When was the last time a church leader called the flock to go and face the tanks? Because that was a special moment. No? And people did, yes, following Cardinal Saint. But I really think people also used their conscience and thought, teka, nakadalwa, ilang decades tayo kay Marcos, ganito pa rin tayo. So,
okay.
That prophecy is always an invitation to go deep. At kung mali, ginagawa yung ginawa ni Bishop Bacani. Sinabi okay. niya na hindi naman ano, pero nagkamali ng discernment si Mike Grande.
Okay. May tatanong ako sa inyo related to that Brother Armin, yung kay Cardinal Sin. Pero I'd like to go first to Professor Jail. No? He mentioned Cardinal Sin. We know his track record during martial law. Of course, the idea early on, yung critical collaboration, but of course, he was very instrumental in the EDSA People Power Revolution in 1986. And he was also active against Joseph Estrada during the campaign for the 1998 elections. still, Estrada won because he was widely popular at that time. Mm-hmm. May pinakamaraming boto na nakuha for a presidential candidate at that time. Now, Jail, you're seeing a lot of members of the church hierarchy, of the Catholic Church hierarchy, making their voices known, endorsing mm-hmm. a particular candidate. Do you see this actually making a difference in terms of, let's say, swaying people's preference away from the clear frontrunner, the son of the late dictator?
My honest answer is it will take time. And maybe Brother Armin can also comment on this. Why? Surveys show, Ian, Brother Armin, that Filipino Catholics do not like it whenever priests or the religious use the pulpit to talk about politics. Take it or leave it. That's a reality. Whenever they go to church, they go there because they want to pray and they want to be prayed for.
Jail, my question, maganda binanggit mo, they don't want their priest to use the pulpit. Eto, this might sound philosophical, pero what if they make use of social media? Is that is that comment limited to the pulpit physically?
That's a good point. Okay, we have to run another survey question for that. The point is, I think for Philippines, it's a very different context of Brother Armin. I think in 1986, people would willingly listen to Cardinal Sin. But I think in 2022, and we've seen this since, 2008, and certainly during the RH Bill debates, right? That parang, oh, bakit nangihimasok pa rin ang Simbahang Katoliko dito? And I really feel for the Catholic Church because I think it's a far more uphill battle for them now than it used to be, right? The whole point of mission and witnessing and conscientization, it's a far more challenging task now for the Catholic Church because Filipinos are, kanina nabanggit natin yung Padre Damaso, and the number two, tired of the politics and church-state separation and so forth, everything that we talked about just now. Yun. And I feel now it will be far more challenging. I think what might work, Christian, is this. Yung values na binambagit ni Brother Armin, let the people may arrive at the conclusion. I think nag-backfire, halimbawa yung Team Buhay at Team Patay, nag-backfire yun at the national scale. At the local level, sa Bacolod, it worked, according to my informants there. But at the national level, hindi siya parang naka-turn off pa siya lalo. So it's a far more tricky moment and tricky act on the part of religious leaders to conscientize their flock.
In short, you have your work cut out for you, Brother Armin, and the rest of the Catholic Church hierarchy. But as a final point, Brother Armin, kanina binanggit niyo na to briefly, no? What makes the situation now so different, so compelling, that members of the Catholic Church hierarchy had to move further, not just guide the flock and encourage them to go through a process of discernment, but to actually endorse candidates? And number two, if you are a Catholic strictly adhering to your values or to your faith, should the choice be that difficult? Again, bago niyo sagutin, babanggitin ko naman, sabihin mo ka nanood, masyado ka naman Katoliko sa question mo. We also know the idea of cafeteria Catholicism, no? So people picking and choosing which particular values or tenets to follow. Brother Armin.
I will be very direct to the point, Christian. The real scare is that BBM may become our next president again. That is a real earth-shaking possibility that the church, I think, now is very, very much afraid of because it's based on kasinungalingan. It's based on this supposed golden age which not only the church, but even Filipinos themselves rejected. Revisionism has seeped into, you know, kami kayo Catholic schools, we're asking ourselves, ako galing DepEd, tinatanong ko, paano ba tinuring history? And part of the real problem is really, we're asking ourselves, itong impluensya ba ng social media is such that it is possible with the help of people, groups like Cambridge Analytica, to reshape the minds, the hearts of Filipinos. And ang tanong ng Katoliko, the Catholic Church, is do we have a role to play ganitong niloloko na tayo, ginugoyo na, at a real threat na baka manalo ulit, tatahimik na labay si Barney, magdadasal na tayo. You know, siguro kung hindi si Marcos Jr. yan, palay ko, the church, given the other opposition candidates, siguro sasabihin, ah, baka pwede naman. That we will leave that to the conscience of individuals. But this is an emergency situation. And, you know, babaliktarin ko yung ang tanong dyan eh. Halimbawa, manalo siya. Can I, as a faithful, say, eh, wala akong magagawa kasi simbahan ako eh. I think parang kay Hitler yan eh. The silence of the church at that time is now hitting us hard. No? And there were voices during that time. Pero as an institution, malakas ba tayo? And I think that is part of the real scare that has hit the church hard. And that's why many of us are coming out publicly.
Okay, Brother Armin Luis Tro and Professor Jail Cornelio, thank you for joining us tonight on the program.
Thank you.
Maraming salamat.
Maraming salamat sa inyo po. So we're going to take a quick break. After the fact, we'll be right back.